Okay. So I want to introduce to you Pastor Kenneth LeBay, right? He is one of our distant students, but he is a pastor in the RCA and had to be in town for church-related business and decided to join us in person. So I want to extend a formal welcome to you and look forward to having you join us and join our conversation. So, okay, men, we're going to get started. Since we will begin talking today about Brockle's teaching on the doctrine of adoption, I want to read the first seven verses of Galatians 4. Galatians 4, first seven verses. Now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, differeth nothing from a servant, though he be lord of all, but is under tutors and governors until the time appointed of the father. Even so we, when we were children, were in bondage under the elements of the world. But when the fullness of time was come, God sent forth his Son, made of a woman, made under the law, to redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. And so what you see beautifully here is that the eternal Son of God becomes the Son of Man, so that the sons of men can become the sons of God. That's the whole purpose, right, of his incarnation, of his coming into the world, which is why he said in John 20, these profound words to Mary Magdalene, he says, go tell my brethren that I ascend unto my God and your God, to my Father and your Father, right? And you see that beautifully expressed here by the Apostle Paul. And he says, because ye are sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. Wherefore, thou art no more a servant, but a son. And if a son, then an heir of God through Christ. Right? Such are the rich privileges of the believer. Ryan, would you ask for a blessing?
Merciful Father, we come before thee and ask that thou would guide us throughout this class, guiding Reverend Elsout as he desires to expound from Brockle the truths which we find in Scripture that are so precious to us. And Lord, that truly these things would not remain only in our minds, but would be pressed home into our hearts. So we ask thy blessing upon each one of us here. There would be much spiritual profit from this class. We ask these things in Christ.
Amen. Okay. So having dealt with Brockle's teaching on the church, we're transitioning now to a consideration of his teaching on the benefits of redemption. And that alone makes his book worth every penny you spend for it. He unpacks those benefits beautifully, and then later on, of course, he deals with many of the virtues of spiritual life. Just an extraordinary spiritual directory on what the benefits of redemption are and what spiritual life looks like. And so we're going to be looking at the adoption of children, the doctrine of what is spiritual peace, the believer enjoys spiritual joy, very important subjects. And then we're going to hopefully look at the doctrine of the Lord's Supper, and then also his teaching on how the life of faith makes use of the promises of God's Word. And if we get beyond that, I would be surprised. But we'll see. We'll keep plugging away. I'm already behind, so I might as well stay behind. So Brockle begins by emphasizing that one of the rich benefits of justification is not merely a negative one. It's not just that I am acquitted in God's court, but it yields the benefit of adoption unto childhood. So he said justification does not only consist in acquittal from guilt and punishment, but also in the bestowal of a right unto eternal life and in God's child being declared an heir of eternal salvation. Hello, Nicodemus. And so to this end, Christ was placed under the law. We just read that. So he concludes in saying, thus justification includes spiritual childhood, and this we shall presently discuss. So Brockle emphasizes the essential connection between justification and adoption. They're like Siamese twins. When God grants the one, he also grants the other. Okay? And God wants his children to understand. And Brockle goes out of his way to make sure that believers do understand that when you're justified by faith, you also become a son, an adopted son of the living God. So he says, you have been adopted as children by him and appointed to be the objects of his fatherly goodness. And then he, in this wonderful paragraph, he expounds for us what an incredible privilege it is to be called a child of God. We're so accustomed to using that expression. But you got to stop and think about it. To be a child of God. To know that the God of the universe is your Father. So he says, the more base the condition of God's child was by nature, the loftier it is to be in the state of being a child of God, and the more glorious it is to be delivered from this misery and to be exalted to such glory. From being a child of the devil to becoming a child of God. From being a child of wrath to becoming the object of God's favor. From a child of condemnation to becoming an heir of all the promises and a possessor of all blessings, and to be exalted from the greatest misery to the highest felicity. This is something which exceeds all comprehension and all adoration. I want you to notice again that Brockle doesn't just state the doctrine of adoption. He goes beyond that. So as you read that paragraph, what strikes you about how he writes here? This is not just dry theology, right? So what strikes you about that paragraph? We're on page 41, lecture number 6, right?
Magnifies the...
Yeah, that's it. But you can sense as he is writing, he's worshiping, right? And brothers, let me emphasize this. When we process God's word properly, when we process it experientially, we will always end up worshiping God, right? And so the Christian doesn't just deal with theology intellectually, right? But it becomes an experiential reality. That's why Luther said doctrine is heaven. And what he meant, doctrine experienced. When I grasp, as a Christian, when I grasp it experientially, that's a foretaste of heaven itself, right? And that's why only someone who understands experientially what it means to be a sinner can marvel at this statement, can marvel at the fact that I, a child of wrath by nature, as Paul says in Ephesians 2, we were all children of wrath, that a child of wrath becomes a child of God. That's incredible. That's an incredible transition and an incredible privilege. That's why he says, I love this statement, he says, a godly beggar is a thousand times more exalted and glorious than the greatest monarch who has ever been in the world. So you take the top honcho in this world, the top political leader. Brockle is saying he doesn't even compare to a godly beggar. To, though he is a beggar by human standards, is a child of the living God. Which is the point Jesus makes in a parable of the rich man and Lazarus. Where he simply is teaching us what really matters. It's not how the world views us. But what really matters is how God views us, right? Again, okay. So in the next page, on page 42, I just want to read this paragraph again. Because it's so beautiful, right? Consider all of this simultaneously, he says, and upon proper reflection will cause a believer with adoration to be in ecstasy and to say, I, who like other men lay in my sins, who was subject to the wrath of God, who was hateful, abominable, and intolerable, I have been known of God from eternity, have been ordained to be his child in his decree. Talking about election. And in time have been snatched from hell. And have been adopted as a child of that great God. I, who am but despised and maimed, have been betrothed to the Son of God, and this with the approbation of his Father, and by reason of the incomprehensible love of the Son. I, who was dead in sins and trespasses, have been quickened by the omnipotent power of the Holy Spirit. I have been born of God. This is incomprehensible and transcends all adoration. However, even though it is marvelous in my eyes, it nevertheless is the Lord's doing. Therefore, I ought to rejoice over all this honor and glory, over such love and benevolence. I shall therefore love him in return and magnify his name to all eternity. This is the unique flavor of Brockle. This is his unique contribution, right? And you know, I've often said it in my own preaching. I've said, if you've never been amazed at God's grace, then you probably have never experienced his amazing grace. Because when this sinks in, that's what the point he's making, when this really sinks in of what God has done in saving you and making you his son, you can't help but be overwhelmed by it, right? So what are some of the privileges? He says, well, God cherishes his children with a fatherly love. And so Psalm 103 says, as a father pitieth his children, so the Lord pities them that fear him. And so the love that God has for us as believers infinitely exceeds the love of an earthly father. So God has his eye upon them as a father to keep them so that no evil will befall them. How safely, he says, may such a child rest and trust under the shadow of his wings. He need neither fear nor be careful, for the Lord cares for him. Number three, since he preserves them, he cares for them in all that they need according to body and soul, so that they need not be concerned as to what they shall eat and drink and wherewithal they shall be clothed, for their heavenly Father knows what they stand in need of. Which is the point Jesus made in Matthew 6. He says, you are of much greater value than the sparrows and than the lilies in the field. So don't be anxious. Don't behave. Don't act like a Gentile. Don't be anxious. Don't bite your nails. Your heavenly Father, he knows what you need and he will provide for you, right? So God has compassion and pity with them in all their bodily and spiritual ailments. It pleases the Lord, he says. There's again the pastoral Brockle, right? He anticipates this. It pleases the Lord to lead his children to heaven through many adversities and tribulations in order that they may thus learn to know and feel their sins, be kept humble, be weaned from the world, be stirred up to prayer, be motivated to trust in him, to attentively acknowledge his help and his preceding grace, to give all things into his hand, and to be satisfied with his government. Because though your heavenly Father loves you, what's Brockle saying here? Though he loves you, what is his objective? What is his overriding objective in your spiritual life as your Father, as your heavenly Father? What do you think he's aiming for?
Image of Christ.
Image of Christ. He's aiming for your spiritual growth, your spiritual prosperity. It's not God's goal to make us comfortable in this life. And that's why the life of the believer will not be free from affliction, because God has appointed affliction precisely to mold us spiritually, right? And so he allows affliction to come into our lives in order that he would conform us to the image of his Son. Then his next paragraph, I'm going to read the whole thing again. I know that's what slows me down, but it's so beautiful, right?
I'm still lost.
Oh, that's not good.
Yeah.
No, we don't want anybody lost in here. So on the syllabus, we're on page 42 of the syllabus.
If you're using PDF format, it's 41.
41. Oh, I see. The pagination is off. 41. So I'm going to be at the bottom of that page now, number 5.
Okay.
See? So he says, since they are children, God hears and answers them as their loving father. As children, they take refuge to their father in their perplexity, and by reason of this relationship, they call him Abba, Father. As you know, that Abba was a very endearing term. It's the equivalent of our daddy, right? In an intimate manner, they bring their needs before him, and with teary eyes, they tell him what their sorrow is. They cry out, "My Father, the cross is so heavy, and it is so very painful for me. It lasts so long, and I don't see my way through. Thou art able to help me, however, for thou hast promised it, and thou dost indeed have compassion with me. Therefore, my Father, help me, support me, and deliver me." Oh, the Lord looks upon such children in love and is pleased with their childlike complaints and their taking refuge to him. He shall most certainly answer them and deliver them at his time and in his manner. If ye then, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to them that ask him? How much more shall your Father which is in heaven give good things to them that ask him? So this is such classic Brockle. He's so positive, and he is reaching out to his reader, and he wants to comfort them with his wonderful doctrine. And that's what you men need to learn from this. That's how you need to minister. That's how you need to preach. Right? As you expound the word of God, is bring it to the hearts of your people. Connect with them and show them how they can benefit from these doctrines, as he so clearly exemplifies for us here. I just need to keep moving here. I had to make a choice. Now, so he also addresses, I'm going to go to the marks of sonship. He addresses what those marks are. So the next to the last paragraph, he says, spiritual childhood or sonship may be recognized by the bearing of God's image. And the analogy is a very simple one. And you can use that analogy. Just like an earthly child looks like its earthly father, bears its father's image, so it is with God's children. So those who have God as their father will reflect their father, right? They will, as you know, there are two words in Greek that are translated as son or child in the New Testament. There's technon, there's huios, right? Technon has to do with our birth, that we're generated by our fathers. But huios is a word that emphasizes that the son has this father's character. He resembles his father in terms of character, right? And so Jesus said, be merciful as your Father in heaven is merciful, right? And so if we really are the sons of the living God, right? If we are really united to him in Christ, then this, some of that will be, ought to be reflected in our lives. That's what Brockle is saying here. But again, he is pastoral. Look at the next paragraph, right? He makes the statement, but he doesn't want his people to be discouraged. He says, as long as we're on this side of eternity, however, the image of God will be imperfect in man. The best among...
Sorry, I interrupted you. What you said about Ion and Technon?
Yeah, so Technon refers to your connection, your generational connection to your father. In other words, that has to do with the fact that you're born of your father, right? He begets you, right? That's the focus of technon. And then huios focuses more on the character, right? As reflecting your father's character, resembling your father, right? I think that's the fine nuance there between those two words. But you can check this out yourself. So we say, as long as we're on this side of eternity, the image of God will be imperfect in man. The best among God's children has but a small beginning and still has much of the old man. This engenders the battle between the spirit and the flesh and its lusts, and a praying against sin for sanctification. Thus this strife yields proof that a person bears the image of God, for if it were all flesh, there would be no opposition and therefore no strife. Instead, there would be peace in the enjoyment of one's earthly pleasures. If you therefore perceive the principle of God's image to be found in you in truth, you may and must proceed with the conclusion that you are a child of God and an heir of eternal life. I'm speaking here of the veracity rather than the degree of the matter, right? So the point he's making is what matters is whether it's in truth, whether I possess some of that image in truth, in reality, right? And not so much to what degree do I possess it, because that fluctuates. But an important practical application he makes, an experiential application, is that he's saying, in a true believer, this causes strife. When a true believer senses in himself that there is still so much that contradicts his spiritual sonship. But for the true believer, that's a matter of grief. That's a matter he struggles with. And Brockle is saying, in the natural man and in the nominal believer, there is no such strife. There is no such opposition. That strife doesn't exist. You see? All right, and then he draws some analogies between natural and spiritual childhood. I'm going to move beyond that. The need to examine oneself whether he is a child of God. Now, this is one of the unique features of Puritan preaching, whether it's English Puritanism or Dutch Puritanism. There was what we call a discriminating element in their preaching. And I'm sure that you're learning about this while you're here. That's part of being enrolled in PRTS, that we hopefully get across to you that faithful preaching always must have a discriminating element in it. We cannot simply assume that all of our hearers are believers. We need to discriminate. We need to call people to self-examination. Christ himself has modeled that for us in his own ministry. But we need to do it in a scriptural way. And now that's what Brockle does here, right? He calls his readers to self-examination. We have thus briefly presented, he is saying, to you the nature of a child of God in order that it would provide both converted and unconverted with a suitable mirror by which they can perceive what their spiritual state is. And so consider now the three marks mentioned earlier together, and if it is your desire to know whether or not you are a child of God, bring yourself into the presence of an omniscient God and compare yourself with these marks. Then listen to what your conscience has to say. Okay. Now he mentions some of the obligations of spiritual sonship, right? Great privilege, just a moment. Great privilege brings with it great responsibility, right? It defines our responsibility. Especially, brothers, the fact that you are believers is because of God's sovereign dealings with you. Sovereign. Sovereignly, God has dealt with your soul. Okay? You're no better than your fellow human beings. But sovereignly, God has plucked you out. And that sovereign distinction, that sovereign privilege, defines your responsibility. It was a question.
Yes, you talked about discriminative preaching.
Yeah.
That means we have to put the law, the gospel, and as well, not take it for granted that everybody who is in the church is already born again.
Right, correct.
Yeah. But, I mean, I agree with you in total. I agree with you. But sometimes when we overdo it, if you preach with distinction, you know, I don't have any problem telling us they both coins. But when you're always on one side,
yeah,
appealing to the people to repent, yeah, of their sins, without knowing that there are some
who have repented,
who have repented
and who have believed.
And, yes, I believe. Right. And you need to help them,
yeah,
go a little bit further. Always, yeah, compared to what happened one time. We are traveling, you know, in Nigeria, we don't have different routes for pedestrians and motorists, the same road.
Yeah.
So we were following, we were in a commercial vehicle, somebody was riding bicycle, and the motorist, the driver, conductor horn, beep, 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 beep.
Yeah.
So the man was already, he had already given chance to pass, but the driver was afraid that...
So he kept on beeping his horn.
He could not say, beep, 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 beep. Until this man left where he was almost in the bush.
Yeah.
Because
the guy was overdoing it.
Yeah, he was thinking that,
yeah,
wrong, where,
yeah,
I am, so,
yeah,
I'm supposed to.
Yeah.
So as he was trying,
yeah,
to cross, so I have to now.
But again, I think, you know, let Brock will be your guide. I think he's a wonderful role model for you,
yeah,
on how to do this and how to do it in a loving way, how to do it in a biblical way, right? Because I agree with you. As a pastor, you can overdo this to such an extent,
yeah,
that you will discourage, mm-hmm, the very people that should be encouraged,
yeah,
right? Because often, it's been my experience, when you call people to self-examination, right, it's usually the true believer who takes that to heart, right? And because the true believer knows his own heart, he knows how deceitful it is. He knows how capable he is of even hypocrisy, right? And so when Jesus said, "One of you will betray me," they all said, "I said I." They had self-knowledge, right? And so it has to be done in a loving way, right? But I'm simply saying, there's so much preaching today where this element is missing.
Yes.
It's completely missing, right? And so you have whole congregations who all presume to be believers, even though there are countless people in there who, by their very lives, manifest the very opposite, right? And so in a loving and wise way, and, you know, as you read more in Brockle, you will see that he's always connecting with the subject he's addressing. He's drawing his application from what he's dealing with, right? And so it's important that when you do preach discriminatingly, that the congregation senses there's a real connection with God's Word, that it comes from the Word of God itself, right? But on the other hand, I think it's necessary. I really think it's necessary. But sometimes what we have to do as pastors then, is then we have to do the opposite as well. And when we have to really reach out to the true believer and set before them the marks of spiritual life in such a way that it will encourage those who have truly put their trust in Christ, right? The obligations of sonship, they're rather self-evident. Obviously, natural children should conduct themselves in such a way that it honors their parents, right? Instead of bringing dishonor upon them. And we, Brockle is saying, we should conduct ourselves as the spiritual sons of God in such a way that we bring honor to our Heavenly Father. Okay? Of course, what I love about this whole chapter on adoption, and whenever Brockle deals with the fatherhood, is the very healthy way in which he deals with this subject, right? I come out of a background where that was not the case. I come out of a background where people were told that only the most advanced among God's children are entitled to God, to call God their father, right? There is nothing in Brockle that even remotely supports such an idea. He, in his writing, he clearly encourages believers to recognize and to acknowledge the fatherhood of God and all of its wonderful implications. So he says, obey God as your father and endeavor to be like him. And he also encourages believers to get along well together, right? As members of the same spiritual household, with the same spiritual father, then we should endeavor to live together in love and in peace. And I believe it greatly grieves our Heavenly Father when members of the same household do not get along well together. Okay? All right. Any questions about this chapter on adoption before we go on and focus on spiritual peace? So another rich benefit of salvation is that it brings peace to our soul, right? Peace between God and us, and a peace that the apostle says passes all understanding. In this peace, Brockle says, the former enmity is taken away. God desists from this, now being reconciled by the blood of his Son, and believers desist from this, now having received another heart by the Holy Spirit. Right? And as you know, the word peace simply means harmony. So when we are at peace with God, that means we have a harmonious relationship with God. Right? It's the very opposite of enmity and hostility. And again, Brockle's point in this chapter is to tell believers that God wants them to enjoy this peace. Right? Sad to say, through our own foolishness and sin, we don't always enjoy that peace. Right? But again, our preaching should be in such a way, right, that we so guide and direct and so shepherd the souls of our sheep, right, that we lead them to such an understanding of the gospel that they experience that peace in their soul, right? Because God is called the God of peace. So Brockle says, all believers, towards the end of the page there, 44, 45, all believers are equally partakers of this peace. That is, as far as their state and the veracity of this matter are concerned. Now here comes the pastoral insight. The application of this peace, however, varies greatly as far as its sensible enjoyment is concerned. Some enjoy it in a greater measure and others in a lesser measure. Some remain in this peaceful condition for a long period and, so to speak, live in it. Others experience this peace rarely and it rapidly dissipates. Yes?
Peace here connecting shorts.
Exactly. But this testifies of wisdom, pastoral wisdom, right? I know pastors, have met pastors who think that full assurance of faith belongs to the essence of faith, right? And that if you lack that full assurance, that disqualifies you from being a believer. And brothers, you will find this in Brockle, and I hope that you will not treat your sheep that way, okay? There are some, and you will find it in your pastoral work, there are souls who struggle. They struggle with assurance. Right? They may have moments in which they enjoy this peace, but it often seems to elude them. Right? And your job as a shepherd is to reach out to them as well, to take them by the hand, to show them the scriptures, and to nudge them in the right direction so that they will experience that peace that is to be found when we look outside of ourselves rather than within ourselves. Let's see here. Yeah?
Small reflection.
Okay.
Yeah, I understand and I agree with you.
I'm glad.
Yeah.
No, I'm teasing.
And sometimes when we talk about spirituality, we think that a spiritual person is somebody who is doubting, who is not really think, oh, I'm so bad.
Yeah.
I don't think God has saved me. I don't think He is that and that. So when we go on home visitation, of course, there are some pitfalls that we have to avoid to give people false hope.
Right.
You know, it is a bad doctor who say, oh, no, no problem. This wound, no.
Yeah,
no.
Yeah, yeah.
And then you patch it.
And just cover it up with a Band-Aid, right?
So
and don't deal with...
Yes, we're afraid to give people false hope.
Yeah.
Yeah, all is right. And because Jeremiah says, what to those prophets who say peace, peace to my people when there's no peace.
And there's no peace.
So that is one way.
That's one way. That's one extreme, yeah.
Yeah, that's one extreme. The other side is we think it is spiritual when somebody is really... doubting and it's not happy. So when you say we have peace, the way the dimension we understand peace from is quite different.
Mm-hmm.
Peace means something, as you said, harmony. It's something that is there.
Mm-hmm.
But do we feel, do we experience a peace? Does that peace bring us joy? That's a different thing.
Yeah.
I understand what
I'm saying. I do understand what you mean.
Yeah.
Right, and so to summarize what you're saying, right, there's the one extreme where we have rank presumption, where people, and I think he's going to address that, in just a moment, we're going to read a paragraph that addresses that. Rank presumption, where there is no spiritual struggle, right? They never have a moment's doubt, never occurs to them. That's the one extreme. The other extreme is... Where people only doubt. Now, what he's alluding to is an environment in which doubting is elevated to be a virtue.
Thank you.
Right? And so doubt is a reality of spiritual life, and Brockle addresses that throughout his work. But it's not a virtue. It's a spiritual weakness. Because ultimately, doubt is a manifestation of unbelief. Right? And it doesn't necessarily mean that the believer purposely is doubtful, right? But we may never elevate it to a virtue. We may never do what he was alluding to, that we say the doubtful person is the most spiritual person.
Yeah.
And that happens, especially in the environment that we come from. And that's simply so unscriptural. And the canons of Dort address that. Right? They address that in a powerful way, and they say to suggest that is to reintroduce the error of the papist. Right? It's to reintroduce Roman Catholicism. Because Roman Catholicism ultimately says you to be sure of your salvation is presumptuous. Right? So that's the other extreme. Ryan. Yeah. Okay. You guys are all wise pastors here. So how do we resolve this? So how do you make a distinction there, Nicodemus?
Well, I don't think that there is really a distinction, in my own opinion, because when somebody is struggling, that person is doubting.
Yeah.
But it is not, I am not doubting so that Reverend Essart will say, oh, he's a spiritual person.
Right.
But it is sincerely in my heart, I really have a moment of darkness, a moment I don't know. But still, God is faithful. It will not remain.
Right.
It will not always remain dark. There will also be moments of glimpse of light.
Right.
And I should also acknowledge that when it do come, and not to overlook that and think that nothing is happening.
See, that's the wisdom of a good pastor. A wisdom of a good pastor is that he acknowledges the existence of doubt, the existence of struggling. And that he comes alongside his sheep and acknowledges the doubt and then tries to identify the reason for the struggle and then points the struggling believer to look outside of himself, right? My dear wife was a struggling soul, right? She often doubted her salvation. And my job was time and again to point her outside of herself, right? Until finally, God graciously so instructed her that she found peace for her soul outside of herself by looking to the finished work of Christ. That's finally brought peace to her soul, right? But the worst thing I could have done is to deal harshly with her, right? And yet I had to lovingly nudge her, right? And my wife always questioned her experience. She questioned whether her knowledge of sin was deep enough, whether she loved Christ enough, and she always disqualified her experience, right? And I kept on telling her, you know, that she needed to look outside of herself. She said to me, if only God would speak very powerfully to me through his word, if there was only a text that would come to me with real power, then I would believe, she said. But I said, dear, I don't think God will give you your wish, because then you would rest in that text. You would rest in that remarkable subjective experience. God will not give you rest until you rest where he wants you to rest. And that is not in some experience, not in some feeling, not in some text, but that you will rest in the finished work of Christ. And that's precisely what happened. And that's where we need pastoral wisdom, right? To so guide and direct our struggling sheep. But our goal should be, our longing should be, is that through our pastoral guidance, we will lead them to this peace and to the experience of it. Ryan?
I guess I'm struggling with not elevating doubt to a virtue. Mm-hmm. But, you know, we are told so often that, okay, if only the elect, theoretically, are the ones that are going to doubt, they're going to experience those inner turmoils of soul and all of these things. So how do we correctly separate that and elevate that to the point where, well, if you have some rumblings in your soul, as it were, the Lord is leading you along, that's a good thing, you know, and not elevating that too much. That's, I guess, my question, separating between the struggle.
Yes, I think even with regard to the issue of that, I'm just thinking what happened to Thomas.
Yeah.
And Christ had to say, see, this is touch, and I'm the one.
Yeah.
And through that way.
So Jesus directed him to himself. That's how he.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And then some translation read that when Jesus first appeared to the 11 disciples,
they
said, well, some
doubted. In Matthew 28.
Yes, some doubted.
Yeah.
Now, I'm beginning to think that there are certain occasions that the children of God will begin to struggle with one sin or in their lives.
Yeah.
Not always happy, joy, like a prosperity gospel preachers will say. If you have believed, there's no thing again.
Yeah.
So I think sometimes this doubtfulness may not be so much considered as we can consider it as disbelief.
Yeah. But you know, it's interesting you mentioned the history of Thomas, right? But you notice that Jesus does not endorse his doubting.
No, it didn't.
And in Greek, it's really powerful. It says, stop being an unbeliever.
Mm-hmm.
Right? That's what it says.
But
stop.
It says, blessed are those who do not see.
But exactly. Exactly. But notice what Christ does. And that's what you're alluding to. He meets him where he's at. He knows that he's struggling. Right? And he resolves it by, as you said, by just directing him to his wounds, right? And that's exactly what we have to do, is direct the struggling believer to the wounds of Jesus. Right? That's where we find peace. In the back here?
Doubt, not necessarily always has to be leading to unbelief. But there are times like John the Baptist, he was in the prison.
Oh, yeah.
Is he the Messiah?
Is he the one?
He was the one who prophesied. I mean, he said, look, behold, the Lamb of God. And the Spirit of God was descending upon him. He said, but after some time he was doubting.
Yeah.
It's kind of weaker faith.
Yeah.
He has a faith, but now he's doubting. It is not unbelief.
Yeah.
It's a weak, at the same time struggling.
Yeah.
So the Spirit of God, the Word of God, would help when we direct towards that. It's not necessarily unbelief. When we deal with it properly, God's word.
Well, when I preach on Thomas, I always say the unbelief of a believer is very different from the unbelief of an unbeliever.
Okay, right.
Very different.
Yeah.
Right? Because as strange as it may sound, the unbelief of a believer is a negative manifestation of his faith. Right? Even Thomas's struggle. His intense struggle that he had. And he was in great darkness. He lost his spiritual peace because of his own foolishness. Mm-hmm. Right? But the reason everything in him ultimately was crying out after Christ. Right? So even though he was in the bondage of unbelief, yet it was the unbelief of a believer, which is very different. Right? All right, Ben. We need to move on a little bit. Oh yeah, on the bottom of the page there, where he talks about how can we maintain this peace, right? I think he makes an important statement there. The one who is at peace has reconciliation with God through Jesus Christ as the basis for his peace. There is no peace as long as sin is not removed. And sin cannot be removed except by the blood of Christ. However, one cannot be a partaker of this except by faith. For this reason... And I love this statement. This is classic Brockel. A gracious person continually goes to Christ. Elsewhere he says, a true believer goes to Jesus thousands upon thousands of times, he says. This is continual going, okay? And so what's critical for the life of faith is this continual taking refuge to Christ. And it's only as we take refuge to him, as we look to him by faith over and over again, that we will experience that peace in our soul, right? He receives his offered atonement as a ransom, humbly and prayerfully comes to the Father while wrestling with the promises, and thus obtains peace. Then he quotes, of course, Romans 50, now the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace. And here comes the critical, in believing. So this peace flows out of our believing. It flows out of the exercise of faith.
Does he deny the use of the practical syllogism?
No, he doesn't deny that. As a matter of fact, he repeatedly refers to it in his work, right? And the use of the practical syllogism, you know, has its, you know, serves its purpose. But I do believe that Brockel ultimately says that abiding peace comes not from just adding 1 + 1 = 2, not just from looking at myself, well, yeah, this is true in my life, that's true in my life, that's true in my life. No, ultimate peace will be found when we look away from ourselves, right? It can be encouraging sometimes, right, to hear from the Word of God what the marks of grace are and to recognize those marks in myself. But my ultimate resting place must be Christ. Christ and Him crucified and His finished work, right? And that leads to abiding peace, okay? And let me read this paragraph on the next page, an exhortation to self-examination. He addresses the whole idea of carnal peace. You, he says, who are not exercised with this peace, are not restless about its absence, are not concerned about having and preserving it, and are not suspicious as to whether or not your peace of mind is of the right sort. You who effortlessly, and as a matter of course, have attained to this peace, that is, without the wrestling of faith, to receive Jesus as a ransom, and to be reconciled by his blood applied to the heart by faith, and only dare to find your conscience purged of dead works. You who have a peace of which God is not the focus, and which you enjoy apart from being in the presence of and in communion with God. You who are always stable and always have and are at peace within, except that shame and harm or a crime may occasionally trouble you, and you're not conscious of the fact that this peace is readily impaired and the heart immediately troubled about the absence of this peace. You who, due to this inner peace of mind, are not prompted to be on guard against all sins, also those of the heart, and to live a life pleasing unto God, I assure you that your peace is nothing but a carnal peace, and that God's eternal and unbearable wrath hangs above your head. Okay? Because the point Brockle is making, that the enjoyment of that peace and the experience of that peace is intimately connected to my walk with God. It's only as I walk with God, as I live in fellowship with him, as I commune with him in and through Christ, that I experience that peace. And so what happens, as you know from your own experience, is that when you sin, you fall into sin, especially if you don't repent of it right away, you lose that peace. Right? God does not endorse our sin. There's no such thing as enjoying this spiritual peace while we're living in sin or while there is unrepentant sin in our life. That peace cannot be restored until, again, we repent and again we take refuge to Christ. And then that peace is restored in our soul, right? Anyway, let's take a 10-minute break, okay? So it's already almost 25 after, so we'll reconvene 25 of, okay? Man, I need to move a little bit faster, but this is such good stuff. He talks about spiritual joy. So the enjoyment of peace, to know that there's nothing between God and my soul, but also the enjoyment of the experience of spiritual joy. And again, this is why Brockle's work is so very healthy. Okay? And again, he recognizes that God wants his children to enjoy salvation. He wants them to enjoy communion with him. He wants them to find joy in him. So Brockle defines this spiritual joy as follows, page 48 or 47. This spiritual joy consists in a delightful motion of the soul generated by the Holy Spirit in the heart of believers, whereby he convinces them of the felicity of their state, causes them to enjoy the benefits of the covenant of grace, and assures them of their future felicity. Now he says, no man can manufacture this joy himself, but it is an inexpressible work of grace by the Holy Spirit. Now the God of hope fill you with all joy. Okay? And so again, God is not a God who grants this reluctantly to his people. He wants his people to enjoy their salvation. And that's why David in Psalm 51, that's what he had lost through his sin. And so he says, restore unto me, not my salvation, but he says, restore unto me the joy of my salvation. That's what he had lost through his sin, right? And again, this is a very tender issue, right? So when we play fast and loose with sin, when we backslide, when we are neglectful in our walk with God, we're going to lose that joy. That spiritual joy is the special privilege of those who walk with God and who seek to live in communion with him, who abide in Christ. That's one of the benefits, right? So therefore he says, look at towards the bottom of 48. If someone considers himself to be joyful and is nevertheless not tender in his walk, but instead lives in the world and yields to his lusts, doing everything with the wrong objective and in seeking self, his joy is not a joy in God, but is a counterfeit joy. Whenever joy proceeds from faith, however, functions in communion with God and begets tenderness, willingness, actual opposition to sin, and the practice of godliness, then there is true joy. Let the heart of such a person rejoice and endeavor to continually live in this joy. Right? And so it's one of those wonderful benefits, again, of the exercise of faith. When we exercise our faith in Christ, look to him, embrace him, and walk with him, and abide with him, we will experience this joy. What else do I want to say about this? So he says on page 49 or 48, where it says, thirdly, that's the fourth paragraph, I believe, God is pleased with the joy of his children. It is his will that they delight themselves, value the benefits, fully trust in his word and his promise, and jubilate, leap for joy, and sing his praises with joyful and singing lips. Cheerfulness and joyfulness are a delight to him. Again, this is healthy stuff. In other words, we don't honor our Heavenly Father when we're always melancholy. You see, there are those times that the Christian has his downtimes and struggles spiritually, but we should endeavor to manifest something of the joy in believing, right? The joy we find in God. So when he says, how do we attain to this joy at the end of the page there? To that end, you should first of all continually exercise faith in Christ. There you have it again. That's the key. That's the essential activity of spiritual life. is exercising faith in Christ. Everything else flows out of that, right? And that's why, men, the devil knows that. That's why he tries everything to shut that down. He tries everything to interrupt our communion with Christ, to interrupt our interacting with Christ. Because once we cease to go to him, once we cease to abide in him, it's only a matter of time before our spiritual life begins to languish, right? So reflect, he says, upon the truths pertaining to the atonement and God's way in which he leads man to salvation, and put your trust in Jesus, leaning upon him. To entrust yourself thus to him without seeing him or apart from any feeling is the way that leads to joy. And so at the end of the chapter he says, be much on guard against yielding to a sinful routine in your life. Even if there are no great faults, this yielding, this drowsy carelessness, this departing from God will readily rob us of this joy. Rather, one ought to refrain from unrighteousness, and upon falling, arise each time again, and immediately run to the fountain once more. I love this. Immediately run to the fountain. And you know, when you and I sin, that's when Satan lies to us. And he tells us you can't go back just like that. Right? No, it's not true. As grievously as it is when we do fall into sin, no, we must immediately go to the fountain without delay. That's what he's saying. This will, time and again, quicken joyfulness. May the God of our exceeding joy gladden you. Okay? Yeah. Then there are two chapters on the Lord's Supper. And again, those are such wonderful chapters, men. Read all three of them, right? And so Brakel, true to the Dutch tradition, right, deals with preparation for the Lord's Supper, celebration of the Lord's Supper, and reflection upon the Lord's Supper, right? Which is, I think, still a wonderful tradition. Again, I have to make a selection here. Bottom of the page, he says, it is the goodness of God that he not only promises the forgiveness of sins to believers, nor only depicts by whom and how they receive the forgiveness of sins, but he furthermore gives them an earnest and seal in order that they would believe that God indeed is and will eternally remain a reconciled God and Father to them in Christ, so that by this knowledge they may live in comfort and joy. And so, why did Christ institute the Lord's Supper? Because he wants his people to be an assured people. He wants us to be assured of our salvation, right? He doesn't want his people to live in doubt. Even though we do, but he doesn't want us to live in doubt. And so he makes every provision we need through the preaching of his word and the administration of the sacraments is to lead us to that assurance of our salvation. Okay? So on the next page, he says it must be administered to true believers. Only true believers have a right for themselves to the promises, Christ, and the communion of saints, and thus also to the signs of the covenant. The church, however, does not judge concerning man's internal state. The knowledge of someone's regeneration is not the basis upon which she admits one to the holy table, but she admits all who have made a conscious confession of the true doctrine of the gospel and who lead a life which is in harmony with their confession. Right, this is what Hodge calls a credible confession. Right, a confession that is not contradicted by one's life. But the point Brakel is making, church cannot judge a man's internal state. And that's what Jean de Labadie, he thought that he had the gift of determining someone's internal state. that he could infallibly determine who were believers and who were true, not true believers. And so he and his followers, they decided who would belong to the church, because Jean de Labardie thought that he could achieve in having a pure church, a church that consisted of true believers only, right? And that's why it failed. And it's those movements have always failed in church history, okay? It's because God does not assign to human beings that only he is capable of doing. And that is to infallibly judge the state of someone's heart. And so that's what Brakel is saying. We admit people on the basis of a credible profession, right? And so the only thing that the church can do is deal with those whose lives contradict it. And how do we do that? By disciplining, right? Exactly. He says something about the frequency. Both time and frequency cannot be determined, and is of no relevance as far as the essence of the sacrament is concerned. I'm just curious, how do we know from the words of institution that Christ obviously had the frequent administration of the Lord's Supper in mind rather than infrequent? What?
As often.
Not as rarely as you do it, but as often as you do it. Okay? And so I, for one, believe that God's church benefits from the frequent administration of the Lord's table, because our faith needs to be frequently strengthened. Right? And so the Dutch tradition of doing it four times a year, as you know, was the result of an arbitrary ruling of the Genevan Council imposed upon Calvin, who did not agree with that at all. And that carried its way into our church order in the Netherlands, right? But that, I don't believe, was Christ's idea. Christ's idea was not to have the Lord's Supper four times a year. I believe that his idea was to have it more frequently.
He said as often as.
As often as, not as, exactly. So how often that should be? He obviously left that open, right? He did not stipulate that. There are those, I was just in England, and in that church they have it weekly, right?
In the Roman Catholic Church, I think they are overdoing their own. In burial,
But of course, what Roman Catholicism has done, it has elevated the sacrament above the preaching, right? And has made the preaching subordinate to, and that's reversing, of course, Christ's order, right? Now, how would you, this as a brief aside, how would you counter the argument of someone who said, if you have the Lord's Supper too frequently, it becomes commonplace? How would you counter that?
It is very commonplace to read my Bible every day. It's very commonplace to read, to pray every day.
Yeah.
It's very commonplace to come to the Lord on my knees every day. Then why should the scripture, why should the sacrament, as a means of grace?
Yeah, as a means of grace.
Be any different?
Yeah. Yeah.
I can fall to read my Bible four times a year and pray four times a year.
I know. I think. But I, as one, I heard one pastor say, "Does kissing your wife every day does that make it commonplace?" You wouldn't know. But anyway, but I mean the point. You understand the point, right? So you wouldn't say, "Well, in order for my wife to really appreciate my kisses, I will kiss her once a week, right? So that she will really appreciate it." No, that, yeah. So, my only concern is, if you do it weekly, does that somehow affect the preaching, the prominence of preaching? I'm just raising it as a question, right? Yeah.
It's so essential. I mean, if you don't have that, what do you have?
Right.
You must have the preparation. So, to take the necessary time.
Right. My personal, and again, you know, my personal view is that I was able in both of my churches to go from 4 times a year to 6 times a year, every other month. Ideally, I would like to see it once a month. And as you know, that's what Calvin finally succeeded in accomplishing in Geneva, that the Lord's Supper was administered monthly. And that to me, what I think would be fruitful. I already saw, by increasing it to 6 times a year, I saw how beneficial that was for the congregation. There's 2 additional times, you know.
How is it in, is it a law that every congregation has to obey, or it depends on every congregation?
Ultimately, no. Ultimately, a local church is at liberty, right? The church order now says that it should be done at least 4 to 6 times a year, right? So that means if you are part of the Heritage Reformed churches, you are obligated to do it at least that many times. But it does not forbid you to do it 8 times,
okay,
or 10 times, right? So the local church is at liberty to change that. Yeah.
Now, in terms of preparation, now I really have a tough time understanding what some Reformed churches follow. Like, do you need to have like once in a 4 months or once in a 3 months your Lord's Supper? And how long do you take for preparation?
So, typically, what happens in our tradition is that the Sunday before the Lord's Supper, a preparatory sermon is preached. The purpose of that sermon is to prepare the congregation for a week of preparation. And then in our tradition, believers during that week, in various ways, prepare themselves for the administration of the Lord's Supper, right? Followed by the administration of the Lord's Supper in the morning, and then in the evening service, there is a reflection sermon in which the preaching then reflects on what transpired in the morning so that believers would reap additional benefit from what happened in the morning. That's our tradition.
But we do have some traditions in India, like Presbyterian Church or CSI, CNI. We have Saturday for preparation service. We have preparation, and then we go Sunday for Lord's Supper.
Oh yeah.
Now my question is, how long one needs for preparation? What are the elements that you focus on preparation? Like in the name of preparation, we do not have a frequent Lord's Supper celebration. I think we miss some points there in the name of preparation and.
But. Let's look at what Brockle has to say about preparation, what preparation looks like, because he addresses that, right? So why do we need preparation, he says? Well, in the very last sentence of that paragraph, he says, whenever the priest would approach unto the altar, they first had to wash themselves. Therefore, we also, when about to approach to the holy table, must first prepare ourselves. Okay? In the opening sentence, he says, it is also God's command that he who approaches unto God in an extraordinary manner should also prepare himself to that end. Right? So, it is an extraordinary event. Right? In a very unique way, God has fellowship with his people. Right? He gathers his people around this table. So, what is the first aspect of preparation? He says, stimulating of desire. So, at the end there, he says, the Lord Jesus, the bridegroom, comes in his love to them to have this supper with them and to cause them to enjoy it together with him. With love and delight, he views them as they surround him. It is there that the Holy Spirit is active, filling the soul with light, grace, and comforts. Okay, so one of the things that you do during a week of preparation in our tradition is you try to read material that focuses you on the person and work of Christ. Right? To stir up a spiritual appetite, if you will. Right? But just like in natural life, just like there are many ways in which you can spoil your appetite, right? By eating inappropriate nourishment, right? So spiritually too, We can do a great deal to spoil our spiritual appetite. So Brakel is saying, you know, we need to, if we really want to benefit from that sacrament, let's stimulate our spiritual appetite. That's what he's saying, right? So typically that means that you try to meditate and you try to read portions of scripture that are suitable or meditations that help you in the stimulation of that spiritual desire, right? Let's see, what else? Fifthly, a little bit down, one exercises communion with Christ in the Lord's Supper. Is not that the focus of all your desires and the essence of your spiritual life? Communion with Christ. Is not your soul troubled in the absence of such communion? It is there that the Lord Jesus assures believers of being a partaker of him as well as of his love toward them. It is there that the Holy Spirit generally works in a more perceptible manner. And so, if during that week of preparation we're so busy and we're so preoccupied that we spend no time alone, no time in meditation, no time in prayer, and then we just rush to the Lord's table, right? We should not be surprised that we remain as cold as a stone, right? That we do not experience. Sometimes our busyness can be due to circumstances beyond our control, and God can graciously still meet us at his table, right? But the point Brakel is making, if you want to enjoy this spiritual meal, if you want to enjoy this spiritual feast, prepare yourself for that spiritual feast. Let's see. So consider, he says, seventhly. So what he's saying, during that week, try to think about what's happening at that table. Try to think about who it is that meets you there. Try to think about what is it that God is visibly confirming to you. What is he visibly setting before you? Consider furthermore the blessed company which gathers there. For there God's children are gathered together before the countenance of their heavenly Father and their beloved Jesus in order to find mutual delight. There they express their love to each other. There they fully separate themselves from the world and despise its love, since they find satisfaction in their mutual love for each other. There they express their love not only for those with whom they are acquainted, but also toward all believers with whom they are not acquainted. Practically, that means that I often emphasized in my preparatory messages, not always, but quite frequently, I said that means that if you're at odds with someone, that has to be resolved this week. You can't both sit at the same table. And I said that includes husband and wives. I said, how can you both come together at the Lord's table when issues between you are not resolved, right? And that way, the frequent administration of the Lord's Supper has the wonderful benefit that it forces you to deal with your relationships, right? Because if you go to the table with unresolved conflict, then do not expect to experience a blessing for your soul, right? That's why Jesus said, don't bother coming to the altar until you have resolved your conflict with your brother, right? So that's part of preparation. The second aspect of preparation is the examination of self. So in the second paragraph, he says this, we just talked about it. When believers make themselves unworthy of the Lord's Supper by giving offense, living in strife and hatred, or cleaving to a given sin to such an extent that prior to the Lord's Supper they do not wish to make a full resolution to part therewith, and thereby they thus sin in a double measure and ought to deeply humble themselves before the Lord. Let such remain in the sanctuary during the administration of the Lord's Supper, stand afar off, and observe the partaking of the Lord's Supper by believers. Let them mourn by themselves and think, I may not be among them. And I had a wonderful illustration of that in my first congregation, of a man of whom I'm convinced he was a child of God, and he didn't come to the Lord's table. And when I approached him and asked him why, he tearfully said, I'm living at odds with my brother, and I didn't resolve it. And because I hadn't resolved it, I couldn't come. Right? And so, but God used the fact that he did not partake to bring him really to his knees, to bring him to repentance, and it resulted in the resolution of an unresolved conflict, right? I want to read, this is a big paragraph, but this is such good stuff. A true believer will perceive within himself that with all his heart, albeit the one time more perceptibly than at other times, he yearns for the Lord Jesus in order to be justified by his blood, to be clothed with his holiness as merited by his fulfillment of the law, and to be renewed and sanctified by his Spirit. He will perceive that he yearns for, longs for, cries for, flees to, waits upon, and surrenders himself to him. He wrestles against unbelief in order that he may bring Jesus into his heart and to be assured that he believes in him and is a partaker of him and his benefits. And again, this is such a fundamental mark of grace. This yearning after Christ. You know, even if we're in a backslidden state, right? And even if our heart is cold, as it is sometimes, if the question is pressed upon us, but tell me, what do you think of Christ? And there's something in a true believer that just cries out after him, right? That's why Peter said, unto them that believe, he is precious, right? And so I always emphasize too, pastorally, right? If Christ is not precious to you, what would you do at the Lord's table? The Lord's table is for people for whom Christ has become precious, right? We come there to remember him, right? We come there to focus upon him. So, secondly, he will perceive that he cannot be satisfied with believing that he has received grace. He desires with all his heart the possession, the enjoyment, and the relish of the benefits of the covenant. He will perceive that he is enamored with being truly united to God, with a life in which there is an impression of the Lord's presence, with peace of conscience, and with the love and fear of the Lord. When he misses this, he's troubled. And if he has lost this, he cannot rest until he receives it by renewal. For this is his life, delight, and felicity. I believe that once we have tasted something of the sweetness of Christ, we're spoiled for the rest of our lives. We are. We will never be truly satisfied again until we get a fresh taste of that, right? And the Lord's Supper is one of those wonderful means ordained by Christ to give us a fresh taste of himself and of who he is. Thirdly, he says, he will perceive within himself a hatred and distaste for sin, a grief when he sins, a repeated rising again, and a fleeing to the blood of Jesus and to reconciliation, and a delight and love to live a life which is pleasing to the Lord. He perceives within himself a warfare between the flesh and the spirit. If someone perceives that these frames and exercises are truly to be found within him, he will be able to come to the table even if he lacks clear assurance. Okay? And so, full assurance is not a requirement for coming to the table, because God has ordained the Lord's Supper to work assurance, to strengthen weak assurance. Right? And so, there is a paragraph in the form for the Lord's Supper that we use in our churches, right? And it's sometimes misinterpreted as if I have to have full assurance. No, the paragraph says, do you believe the promise of the gospel? That if you trust in Jesus, your sins shall be forgiven. Do you believe that promise? Right? That's the point that's being made there. Okay. The third aspect of preparation is spiritual adornment. Okay. And so the simple analogy that he uses is simply this. When we go to a major banquet, we prepare ourselves for it. We get dressed. We get dressed appropriately, right? So he's saying there's certain things we need to do spiritually to get ready for this wonderful feast, this wonderful banquet that God has prepared for us. So he mentions as some of the so we meditate and reflect upon the work of redemption, he says. Secondly, try to foster a spiritual frame. And you do that by meditation, by reading scripture, by prayer, by meditating upon appropriate material, is to try to stimulate your spiritual appetite. Do it, he says, by restoring and renewing the covenant of grace. Give heed to the sincere, earnest, and urgent invitation and calling of the Lord Jesus. Listen to his lovely voice. Stir up your desires thereby. And by way of that covenant, surrender yourselves earnestly and willingly to the Lord Jesus, if you had never done so before, and say, I now do this with my whole heart, and by this covenant I wish to and shall live and die. Adorn yourself by making a sincere resolution to lead a more holy life. Sixthly, by consistent having a heart which is moved in love towards all God's children, regardless of whether one knows them or not. Yea, a heart filled with love which extends to all men. In other words, when you sit at the Lord's table, when you partake of the Lord's table, you need to be able to look around the table and say before God, I love them all. That's how it should be. They're all members of the same family, right? With the same spiritual household. And I think that whole idea of the communion of saints being visible in the Lord's Supper, right, the communion among the members of the same family, I think that some of that gets lost when you don't have an actual physical table, right? I think there's something beautiful about the people of God coming forward and being seated around the table, right? And that's lost, I think, when you don't do that. I felt that when I was in England, we had the Lord's Supper, and it was good to be there, but the elements were distributed throughout the church rather than the people of God coming forward, right? Which is a very common practice, of course, in our day today. But at least in our tradition, we have still preserved the coming to the table itself, which that's something I would hate to lose. I think there's something beautiful about the, you know, there being this visible element to the family and to the household of God, right?
The members are allowed to say no.
What?
If they are giving me the element, do I have the freedom to say no? These people that dispute it in the pew.
Yeah. So, okay. We fence the table, right? That means we do have table watchers, but those table watchers cannot act on their own. They cannot make that decision themselves.
Well, I mean, this church in England that dispute the element to people while they are sitting, they don't come forward as we do.
No.
They come forward.
Yeah, no. Oh, no. But in most churches in North America, you stay in your bench. And you have all the elders and deacons, and they pass it through to the pews.
Okay.
The wine and the bread and the wine. That's a common practice in North America. But I have to say, I don't like it.
And I think those people who are sitting there are those who are prepared to go to take the Lord's Supper.
Well, that's left to their conscience, of course, right? Because the whoever is handing it out, they're passing it. It goes through the row, and it's up to you whether you then take what's passing by you, right? And so in our tradition, getting up out of your seat and going forward is already a public confession of faith.
Yes.
And that element is lacking when that does not happen, right?
There's no way to really fence the table.
And there's no way of fencing the table.
Yeah.
No. And so in our tradition, what that simply means is that the elders make sure that no one who is under discipline partakes the Lord's table. Because that's what one of the results of discipline is, that it closes the table to the one who's being disciplined, right?
So how do you do, like, in churches where there are so many people, 1,000+?
It's a good question. That means sometimes, I know of churches in the Netherlands where they have the Lord's Supper in the morning and evening service. They, you know, they have several tables in the morning and several tables at night, right? Gets a bit complicated when you have a large church like that.
Yeah, because in my background, that's what we do, like we serve in the pews.
Oh, yeah.
But what is done is there's preparation on Saturday. So those people who go to preparation, they are given
a token.
Card, yeah.
Oh, I see. Like in the Church of Scotland, right? You get a token.
Yeah.
Right.
So
yeah.
I think that when you go and you get that, that's like...
Yeah, we don't do that in our tradition, no.
That would be a formality.
Yeah, that would be... we just stress the necessity of proper biblical self-examination. And then the invitation is granted, right? And the table is opened to all those who have made a credible profession. All of them are permitted to partake, right? I've only in my lifetime experienced it once that an elder denied access to the table. And he was correct in what he did. This person was not a professing member. And he knew that this person was living in open sin, and this person at the emotion of a moment just got up and came to the table, and he denied him access. Family was furious at him for doing that, but he was correct in what he did, and I told him so. But that's kind of a solemn moment when that happens. So then the celebration of the Lord's Supper.
Abrakal, he gives one more advice, like, you do fasting prayer.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's true.
For preparation. That's a wonderful thing that most of the churches we don't follow.
He has a whole chapter on fasting.
And especially for preparation for the Lord's Supper.
Yeah.
That would be a wonderful practice.
Now, in his chapter on fasting, he does not promote it as a prescription. He's not saying that you're required, but he's simply saying that it can be a very useful practice in enhancing your spiritual sensitivity, right? And that's how he also deals with it in that chapter, right? And so I would agree with you. I don't know how it's in India, but that's a practice that's almost lost, I think, in the Western culture, the whole idea of fasting, right?
Especially in the Reformed Presbyterian
Church.
Yeah. We lost it.
Yeah, we lost. Yeah, I'm afraid so. I'm afraid so. Yeah, yeah. Okay, the celebration of the Lord's Supper. I'm just running out of time, folks. When sitting at the table, he said, consider yourself to be in the presence of God, your heavenly Father, and Christ your bridegroom. Sink away in your insignificance, let a childlike awe and reverence arise in your soul, while saying, surely the Lord is in this place. This is none other but the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven. What a beautiful statement. What a beautiful experiential statement. Now, but then, he also... Again, pastorally, he says, neither expect a miracle here or an extraordinary measure of elevation, light, or ecstatic joy. If the Lord gives you this, enjoy this good thing, while it may be your portion. Be it known, however, that this is the common way to exercise faith and to assure you by means of these signs, as being seals and pledges, that as certainly as you eat that bread and drink that wine, so certain is it that Christ has died for you and loves you. Thus strive to attain peace in your conscience by faith. Exactly. Right? So it is God's normal way to assure us sacramentally, right? Sometimes emotionally, Sometimes we get the assurance of sense, but it's God's primary goal is to give us the assurance of faith. All right, and then also we have reflection upon the Lord's Supper. He says, be very careful to conduct yourself well after the Lord's Supper. If Satan has not been able to gain the advantage over you in the preparation for and celebration of the Lord's Supper, he will yet endeavor to get the advantage over you after the Lord's Supper, right? And he mentions the fact how after Jesus had been baptized, he was tempted of the devil. So Brockle is simply saying that reflection is an important component as well, right? That's almost like the digestion process. We have eaten it and now we digest what has taken place. Reflection must consist in the anticipation and enjoyment of having fellowship with God. To that end, he says, it is necessary that one views God in Christ as a reconciled Father. Even when spiritual life dissipates, if one falls into sin and if strife comes, one must nevertheless hold fast to the immovableness of the covenant. It is neither your feeling nor your standing or falling which determines the steadfastness or stability of the covenant. Rather, it is based on the immutability of God. Right, and that's what the Lord's Supper confirms, is the immutability of God's promises, the steadfastness of his covenant, the unbreakableness of the covenant. He says, if according to your feeling, you cannot conclude the certainty of your state, then make the conclusion judgmentally. Observe this in the following passages. Likewise, reckon ye yourself also to be dead unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So reflection, he says in our next page, consists in the despising and abandoning of the world. You are obliged to abandon the world, for this is inherent in the covenant to which you have entered and which has been sealed to you. This means that God alone is my desire, resting place, joy, delight, and the one whom I fear. The world is therefore from now on of no significance. It is merely to be used as a means through which one traverses as a stranger in order to come to the fatherland. So what he's saying, that a proper reflection on the Lord's Supper results in a sanctified life. Right, so my conduct in the week that follows, for sure, should be such that people can see that we've been with Christ, we've been in his company, we've been in his presence, we've been fed at his table. It should have a sanctifying influence. So reflection, he says, consists in a public manifestation that one is a Christian and a member of the covenant. Therefore, from now on, wear the livery of Christ by walking as he walked, so that all who observe you may know that you are loyal to Jesus and his cause. Okay? And then a final pastoral paragraph. Many are desirous for all these spiritual frames and complain that they don't have them. This is what you will encounter as a pastor. They indeed have much reason for this. However, what is the reason for all this? They themselves are certainly to be blamed, for they are lax in seeking. It's too difficult a duty for them to be thus engaged, in spite of darkness and spiritual dullness. He who does not work will not eat. He who does not pray will not receive. He who does not seek will not find. In the realm of nature, God grants temporal blessing only upon the use of means. God deals likewise in the spiritual realm. Therefore, if you desire these things, actively seek them. Right? So again, all these gifts are God's gracious and sovereign gifts, but he bestows them upon us in the faithful, prayerful, and diligent use of the means. And that brings us to Brockle's teaching on the promises, but that we will have to leave for next week, the Lord willing. Okay. All right. By the way, these chapters on the Lord's Supper, When my father was a young minister, he found them so instructive. He had a publisher publish them separately, just for the benefit of the Lord's people. So, that's still around. Yep. All right. Let's close with prayer. Ken, would you lead us in a word of prayer? Yeah. Amen. All right, men. So next week we just have a 1 hour session again. We're back to normal and it'll stay that way the rest of the semester. All right? So keep thinking about what kind of paper you're going to write. Anyway, Ken, it was so good to have you here. Go ahead.
Are you a student?
Yeah, he is a long distance student. Normally he watches us, but he had to be in town. He has to be in town today, so he decided to join us.
Okay, good.
Yeah. He's a pastor in the Reformed Church of America.
Okay. He'll help.